on your hour?
'Tis now so 12. Get thee to bed, Francisco.
For this relief, much thanks. 'Tis bitter cold, and I am sick at heart.
Have you had a quiet guard?
Not a mouse stirring.
Well, good night. If you do meet Horatio and Marcellus, the rivals of my watch, bid them make haste.
I think I hear them. Stand out, who's there? Rents to this ground.
And leads them to the Dane.
I give thee good night.
Well, farewell, honest soldier. Who hath relieved you? Bernardo hath my face.
Give thee good night.
Hello, Bernardo.
Say, what is Horatio there?
Peace of him.
Welcome, Horatio. Welcome, good Marcellus.
What? Has this thing appeared again tonight?
I have seen nothing.
Horatio says 'tis but a fantasy, and will not let the leaf take hold of him, touching his dreaded sight twice seen of us. Therefore, I have entreated him along to watch the minutes of this night, that if again this apparition come, he might approve our eyes and speak to it.
Tush, tush, 'twill not appear.
Let us once again assail your ears that are so fortified against our story, which we have two nights seen.
Peace! Bring me off the overcoats again!
In the same figure of the king that's dead!
Thou art a scholar. Speak to it, Horatio.
Looks he not like the king? Mark it, Horatio.
Most like. It harrows me with fear and wonder.
Would be folk too.
Speak to it, Horatio.
What art thou that usurps this time of night, together with that fair and warlike form in which the majesty of buried dead mark did sometimes march? By heaven, I charge thee, speak.
Offended.
See, it stalks away.
Stay! Speak! Speak! I charge thee, speak!
Gone and will not answer.
Oh, now, Horatio, you tremble and look pale. Is not this something more than fantasy?
You think you want it? Before my God, I might not this believe without the sensible and true avouch of mine own eyes.
Is it not like the king?
As thou art to thyself.
Thus twice before, and jump at this dead hour, with martial stock at thee gone by our watch.
Soft, behold, lo, where it comes again. I'll cross it, though it blast me. Stay, illusion. If thou hast any sound or use of voice, speak to me. If there be any good thing to be done which may to thee do ease and grace to me, speak to me. Or if thou art privy to thy country's fate, which happily foreknowing may avoid, oh, speak! Or if thou hast deported in thy life extorted treasure in the womb of earth, for which they say you spirits oft walk at death, speak of it! Stay and speak! Stop it, Marcellus!
Shall I strike at it?
Do if it will not stand. 'Tis here! 'Tis here!
'Tis gone. We do it wrong being so majestical, for it is as the air invulnerable, and our vain blows malicious mockery.
It was about to speak when the cock crew.
Indeed, it faded on the crowing of the cock.
Look, the morn in russet mantle clad walks o'er the dew of high on eastward hill. Break me our watch. By my advice, let us impart what we have seen tonight unto young Hamlet. For on my life, this spirit dumb to us will speak to him. If you consent, we shall acquaint him with it, as needful in our loves fitting our duty.
Let's do it, I pray. And I this morning know where you shall find him most conveniently.
Endured in marriage in equal scales, weighing delight and dole, taken to wife. Nor have we herein barred your better judgments, which have so far gone with this affair along. For all our thanks. And now, Laertes, what's the news of you?
My dread lord, you're leaving part to return to France, from whence though willingly I came to Denmark to show my duty in your coronation. But now I must confess my duty done, and my thoughts and wishes bend again toward France, and bow to your gracious leaving part.
Have you your father's leave? What says Polonius?
He hath, my lord, wrung me from my slow leave by laborsome petition, and at last upon his will I sealed my hard consent. I do beseech you, give him leave to go.
Take thy fair hour, Laertes. Time be thine, and thy best graces. Spend it at thy will. But now, my cousin Hamlet and my son.
A little more than kin and less than kind.
How is it that the clouds still hang on you?
Not so, my lord. I'm too much in the sun.
Good Hamlet, cast thy knighted color off, and let thine eye look like a friend on Denmark. Do not forever with thy veiled lid seek thy noble father in the dust. Thou knowest 'tis common. All that lives must die, passing through nature to eternity.
I imagine it is common.
If it be, why seems it so particular with thee?
Seems, madam. Nay, it is, I know not seems. 'Tis not alone my inky cloak, good mother, nor customary suits of solemn black, nor the fruitful river in the eye, nor the windy suspiration of forced breath, nor the dejected haviour of the visage, together with all forms, moods, shapes of grief that can denote me truly, these indeed seem, for they are actions that a man might play. But I that within which passes show, these but the trappings of the suits of woe.
'Tis sweet and commendable in your nature, Hamlet, to give these mourning duties to your father. But you must know, your father lost a father, that father lost his, and the survivor bound in filial obligation for some term to do obsequious sorrow. But to persever in obstinate condolements, 'tis a course of impious stubbornness. 'Tis unmanly grief, Hamlet. We pray you, cast to earth this unprevailing woe, and look to us as of a father. For let the world take note, you are the most immediate to our throne, and for your intent in going back to Wittenberg, it is most retrograde to our desire. And we bend you, beseech you to remain here in the cheer and comfort of our eye, our chiefest courtier, cousin, and our son.
Let not thy mother lose her prayers, Hamlet. I pray thee, stay with us. Go not to Wittenberg.
I shall in all my best obey you, madam.
Why, 'tis a loving and fair reply, be as ourselves in Denmark. Madam, come. This gentle and unforced accord of Hamlet sits smiling in my heart, with no jocund health that Denmark drinks today. And the great cannon of the clouds shall tell, the kings rouse the heavens all bruit again, re-speaking earthly thunder. Come away.
Tears. Why, she, even she, oh God,
beast that once discourse of reason would have mourned longer. Married with my uncle, my father's brother, but no more like my father than I to Hercules within a month. Ere yet the salt of her most unrighteous tears had left the flushing of her galled eyes, she married. Oh, most wicked speed, to post with such dexterity to incestuous cheeks, it is not, nor it cannot come to good. But break my heart, for I must hold my tongue.
Hail to your lordship.
I am very glad to see you well, Horatio, or I do forget myself.
The same, my lord, and your poor servant ever.
Sir, my good friend, I'll change that name with you. And what make you from Wittenberg? Horatio? Marcellus?
My good lord.
I'm very glad to see you. Good even, sir. But what in faith make you from Wittenberg?
A truant disposition, my lord.
I know you are no truant. But what is your affair in Elsinore? We'll teach you to drink deep ere you depart.
My lord, I came to see your father's funeral.
I pray thee, do not mock me, fellow student. I think it was to see my mother's wedding.
Indeed, my lord, it followed hard upon.
Thrift, Horatio. The funeral baked meats did coldly furnish forth the marriage tables. Would I had met my dearest foe in heaven, wherever I had seen that day. Horatio, my father, methinks I see my father.
Where, my lord?
In my mind's eye, Horatio.
I saw him once. He was a goodly king.
He was a man. Take him all in all. I shall not look upon his like again.
My lord, I think I saw him yesternight.
Saw? Who?
My lord, the king, your father.
The king, my father?
Cease in your admiration with an intent ear for a while, till I can deliver to you upon the witness of these gentlemen this marvel.
For God's love, let me hear.
2 nights together have these gentlemen, Marcellus and Bernardo, when on their watch a figure like your father, armed at once exactly, a cock of hay, appears before them with solemn march into a slow and stately vibe. Thrice he walked by their oppressed and fear-surprised eyes, whilst they stand dumb and speak not to him. This to me in dreadful secrecy and appointment did, and I with them the third night kept the watch, where, as they delivered, both in time, form of coming, each word made true and good, the apparition comes. I knew your father. His hands are not alike.
But where was this?
My lord, upon the platform where we watched.
Did you not speak to him?
My lord, I did, but answer made it none. Yet once methought it lifted up its head and did adjust itself to motion, like as it would speak. But even the morning cock crew loud, and at the sound it shrunk in haste away and vanished from our sight.
'Tis very strange.
As I do live, my honored lord, 'tis true. But we did think it writ down in our duty to let you know of it.
Indeed, indeed, sirs, but this troubles me. Hold you the watch tonight?
We do, my lord.
Saw you his face?
Oh, yes, my lord.
What? Look at you distractedly.
Countenance more in sorrow than in anger.
Pale or red?
Nay, very pale.
And fix his eyes upon you.
Most constantly.
I would I had been there.
It would much amaze you.
I will watch tonight. Perchance we'll walk again.
I warrant it will.
If it assume my noble father's person, I'll speak to it. And whatsoever else shall have tonight, give it no tongue. So fare you well. Upon the platform, twixt 11 and 12, I'll visit you.
Our duty to your honor.
Your love is mine to you. Farewell. My father's spirit. All is not well. I doubt some foul play. Would the night were come? Till then, sit still, my soul. Foul deeds will rise, though all the earth overwhelm them, true men's eyes.
Nature, forward, not permanent, sweet, not lasting, perfume and suppliance of a minute, no more.
No more, but so.
Think it no more, for nature crescent does not grow alone in thews and bulk. But as this temple waxes, the inward service of the mind and soul grows wide withal. Perhaps He loves you now, and now no soil nor coddle doth besmirch the virtue of his will. But fear it, Ophelia. His greatness weighed, his will is not his own. For he himself is subject to his birth, and may not, as unvalued persons do, carve for himself. For on his choice depends the safety and health of this whole state. Fear it, Ophelia. Fear it, dear sister. Keep you in the rear of your affection, out of the shot and danger of desire.
I shall the effect of this good lesson keep as watchman to my heart. But good, my brother, do not, as some ungracious pastors do, show me the steep and thorny way to heaven, whilst, like a puffed and reckless libertine himself, the primrose path of Dalliance treads, and wrecks not his own greed.
Oh, fear me not. I stay too long. But here my father comes. Occasion smiles upon a second week.
Yet here, Laertes, aboard, aboard, for shame. The wind sits in the shoulder of your sail, and you are stayed for. There, my blessing with thee, and these few precepts in thy memory. Give thy thoughts no tongue, nor any unproportioned thought his act. Be thou familiar, but by no means vulgar. Beware of entrance to a quarrel. Give every man thy ear, but few thy voice. Take each man's censure, but reserve thy judgment. Neither a borrower nor a lender be, for loan oft loses both itself and friend, and borrowing dulls the edge of husbandry. This above all, to thine own self be true, and it must follow, as the night the day, thou canst not then be false to any man. Farewell, my blessing season this in thee.
Most humbly do I take my leave.
Time invites you. Go.
Remember well that I've said to you, Ophelia.
Tis in my memory locked, and you yourself shall keep the key of it.
Farewell.
What is it, Ophelia, he hath said to you?
So please you, something touching the Lord Hamlet.
Marry, well bethought. Tis told me he hath very oft of late given private time to you. And you yourself have of your audience been most free and bounteous. If it be so, as so tis put on me, and that in way of caution I must tell you, you do not understand yourself so clearly as it behooves my daughter in your honor. What is between you? Give me up the truth.
He hath, my lord, of late made many tenders of his affection to me.
Affection? Pooh! You speak like a green girl, unsifted in such perilous circumstance. Do you believe his tenders, as you call them?
I do not know, my lord, what I should think.
Marry, I'll teach you. Think yourself a baby, that you have taken these tenders for true pay, which are not sterling. Tender yourself more dearly, or not to crack the wind of the poor phrase running it thus, you'll tender me a fool.
My lord, he hath importuned me with love in honorable fashion.
Aye, fashion you may call it. Go to, go to.
And have given countenance to his speech with almost all the holy vows of heaven.
Aye, spring just to catch woodcocks. I do know how prodigal the soul lends the tongue of vows. From this time, be somewhat scanter of your maiden presence. Send your entreatments at a higher rate than a command to parley. For Lord Hamlet, believe so much in him that he is young, and with a larger tether may he walk than may be given you. In few, Ophelia, do not believe his vows, for they are mere implorers of unholy suits. This is for all. I would not, in plain terms, from this time forth, have you so slander any woman pleasure, as to give words or talk with the Lord Hamlet. Look to it, I charge you, come your ways.
I shall obey, my lord.
Thank you.
The air bites truly. It is very cold. It is a nipping and an eager air.
What hour now?
I think it lacks of 12.
No, it is struck.
Indeed? I heard it not. Then it draws near the season wherein the spirit held its wont to walk. Look, my lord, it comes!
Oh, angels and ministers of grace, defend us. Be thou a spirit of health or God and damned. Bring the airs from heaven or blasts from hell. Be thy intents wicked or charitable. Thou comest in such a questionable shape that I will speak to thee. I'll call thee Hamlet, King, Father, Royal Dano, answer me. Let me not burst in ignorance, but tell me why thy canonized bones, cursed in death, have burst their cerements. Why, the sepulchre wherein we saw thee quietly inert has oped its ponderous and marble jaws to cast thee up again. What may this mean? That thou dead course again in complete steel? We visitest thus the glimpses of the moon, making night hideous and we fools of nature. So horridly to shake our disposition with thoughts beyond the reaches of our souls. Say, why is this? Wherefore, what should we do?
It beckons you to go away with it, as if it's some impertinent desire to you alone.
Look with what courteous action awaits you to more roofs ground. But do not go with it.
No, by no means.
It will not speak. Then I will follow it.
Not, my lord.
Why? What should be the fear? I do not set my life upon a pen's fee. And as for my soul, what can it do to that, being the thing immortal as itself? It waves me forth again.
I'll follow it. What if they tempt you toward the flood, my lord? Or to the dreadful summit of the cliff, and there assume some other horrible form which might deprive your sovereignty of reason and draw you into madness? Think of it.
It waves me still. Go on, I'll follow you.
Shall not go, my lord.
Hold up your hands.
Be ruled. You shall not go.
My fate cries out and makes each petty artery in this body as hardy as an immune brain's nerve. Still at my cold. Unhand me, gentlemen. By heaven, I'll make a ghost of him that loves me. I say away. Go on, I'll follow thee.
He waxes desperate with imagination.
Let's follow, 'tis not fit thus to obey him.
Have after. To what issue will this come?
Something is rotten in the state of Denmark.
Heaven will direct
him. Nay, let's follow him.
Where wilt thou lead me? Speak, I'll go no further.
Mark me.
I will.
My hour is almost come, when I to sulphurous and tormenting flames must render up myself.
Alas, poor ghost.
Pity me not, but lend thy serious hearing to what I shall unfold.
Speak, I am bound to hear.
So art thou to revenge when thou shalt shear.
What?
I am thy father's spirit, doomed for a certain term to walk the night, and in the day confined to fasten fires.
Till the foul crimes done in my days of nature are burnt and purged away.
But that I am forbid to tell the secrets of my prison house, I could a tale unfold whose lightest word would harrow up thy soul, freeze thy young blood, make thy two eyes like stars start from their spheres, thy knotted and combined locks to part, and each particular hair to stand on end, like quills upon the fretful porpentine. But this eternal blazing must not be to ears of flesh and blood. List, list, oh list, if thou didst ever thy dear father love.
Oh God!
Revenge is foul and most unnatural murder.
Murder?
Murder most foul, as in the best it is, but this most foul, strange, and unnatural.
Haste me to know it, that I, with wings as swift as meditation or thoughts of love, may sweep to my revenge.
I find thee apt, now, Hamlet, here. 'Tis given out that sleeping in my orchard a serpent stung me, so the whole year of Denmark is by a forged process of my death, rankly abused. But know, thou noble youth, the serpent that did sting thy father's life now wears his crown.
Oh, my prophetic soul, my uncle!
Ay, that incestuous, that adulterate beast, with witchcraft of his wit and traitorous gifts. Oh, wicked wit and gifts that have the power so to seduce one to his shameful lust, the will of my most seeming virtuous queen. But soft. Methinks I scent the morning air. Brief let me be.
Sleeping within my orchard, my custom always of the afternoon, upon my secure hour.
Thy uncle's soul, with the juice of cursed Hebena in a vial, and in the porches of my ears did pour the leprous distillment, whose effect holds such an enmity with blood of man, that swift as quicksilver it courses through
the natural gates and alleys of the body, and with a sudden vigor doth posset and curd,
like eager droppings into milk, the thin and wholesome blood, so did it mine, and a most instant tetter barked about, most lazar-like, the vile and loathsome crust all my smooth body.
Thus was I, sleeping by a brother's hand,
of life, of crown, of queen,
at once dispatched, oh horrible,
most horrible. If thou hast nature in thee, bear it not. Let not the royal bed of Denmark be a couch for luxury and damned incest. But howsoever thou pursuest this act, taint not thy mind, nor let thy soul contrive against thy mother aught. Leave her to heaven, and to those swords that in her bosom lodge to prick and sting her.
Fare thee well at once.
The glowworm shows the matin to be near, and gains to pale his ineffectual fire.
Adieu,
Hamlet, remember me.
O all you host of heaven, O earth, what else then shall I couple hell? O fie, hold my heart, and you my sinews, grow not instant old, but bear me stiffly up. Remember thee. Aye, thou poor ghost, while memory holds a seat in this distracted globe, remember thee. Yea, from the table of my memory, I'll wipe away all trivial fond records, all saws of books, all forms, all precious past that youth and observation copied there. And thy commandment all alone shall live within the book and volume of my brain. Oh, what pernicious woman. Oh, villain, smiling, damned villain. One may smile and be a villain. At least I'm sure it may be so in Denmark. So, uncle, there you are. Adieu, remember me. I've sworn.
My lord.
Here's Hamlet.
Heaven secure him.
So be it.
Hillo, ho ho, my lord.
Hillo, oh ho, boy. Cumbered, come.
How is it, my noble lord?
What news, my lord?
Oh, wonderful.
Good, my lord, tell it.
No, you'll reveal it.
Not I, my lord, by heaven.
Nor I, my lord.
How say you, then? Would heart of man once think it? But you'll be secret.
Aye, by heaven, my lord.
There's ne'er a villain dwelling in all Denmark, but he's an arrant knave.
There needs no ghost, my lord. Come away from the grave to tell us this.
What right, you are in the right, and so without more circumstance at all, I hold it fit that we shake hands and part. You, as your business and desire, shall point you, for every man has business and desire, such as it is. And for mine own poor part, look you, I'll go pray.
These are but wild and whirling words, my lord.
I'm sorry they offend you heartily. Yes, faith, heartily.
There is no offense, my lord.
Yes, by St. Patrick, but there is Horatio, and much offense, too. Touching this vision here, it is an honest ghost. That let me tell you. For your desire to know what is between us, overmaster it as you may. And now, good friends, as your friends, scholars and soldiers, give me one poor request.
What is it, my lord? We will.
Never make known what you have seen tonight.
My lord, we will not.
Aye, we will not.
Nay, but swear it.
Not I, my lord, in faith.
In faith, my lord, nor I.
Upon my blade!
We have sworn, my lord, already.
Indeed, upon my blade, indeed.
Swear.
Ah, boy, sayest thou so? Art thou there, true penny? Come on, you hear the fellow in the cellarage. Consent to swear.
Propose the oath, my lord.
Never to speak of this that you have seen. Swear upon my blade.
Swear.
Oh, day and night, but this is wondrous strange.
And therefore, as a stranger, give it welcome. There are more things in heaven and earth, Horatio, than are dreamt of in your philosophy. But come, here as never, so help you mercy. How strange or odd some'er I bear myself, as I perchance hereafter shall think meet, to put an antic disposition on, that you at such times, seeing me never shall, with arms encumbered thus, or this head shake, or by pronouncing of some ambiguous phrase, or such ambiguous giving out, to know that you know aught of me. This not to do. Swear.
Swear.
Rest, perturbed spirit. So, gentlemen, with all my love I do commend me to you, and what so poor a man as Hamlet is,
May do to express his love and friending to you. God willing shall not lack. Let us go in together, and still your fingers on your lips. I pray thee, the time is out of joint. O cursed spite, that ever I was born to set right. Nay, come, let's go together.
We both obey, and here give up ourselves in the full bent to lay ourselves freely at your feet. To be commanded.
Thanks, Rosencrantz and gentle Guildenstern.
Thanks, Guildenstern and gentle Rosencrantz. And I beseech you instantly to visit my too-much changed son.
Heavens make our presence and our practices pleasant and helpful to him.
Aye, amen.
Now, Father, good news.
Am I, my lord? I share my good liege. I hold my duty as I hold my soul, both to my God and to my gracious king. And I do think, or else this brain of mine hunts not the trail of policy so sure as it hath used to do, that I have found the very cause of Hamlet's lunacy.
Oh, speak of that. That you are long to hear.
I doubt it is no other but the main. His father's death, and our or hasty marriage.
Well, we shall sift him.
My liege and madam, to expostulate. What majesty should be? What duty is? Why day is day, night, night, and time is time. We're nothing but to waste night, day, and time. Therefore, since brevity is the soul of wit, and tediousness the limbs and outward flourishes, I will be brief. Your noble son is mad. Mad, I call it. For to define true madness, what is but to be nothing else but mad? But let that go.
More matter with less art.
Madam, I swear I use no art at all. That he is mad. Tis true, tis true. Tis pity, and pity tis true. A foolish figure, but farewell it, for I will use no art. Mad! Let us grant him then. And now remains that we find out the cause of this effect. Or rather say, the cause of this defect. For this effect's defective comes by cause. Thus it remains, and the remainder thus. Prepare. I have a daughter, have while she is mine, who in her duty and obedience hath given me this. Now gather and surmise. To the celestial and my soul's idol, the most beautified Ophelia. That's an ill phrase. A vile phrase. Beautified is a vile phrase, but you shall hear. Thus, in her excellent white bosom, these, etc.
Keep this from Hamlet to her.
Good madam, stay a while. I will be faithful. Doubt thou the stars are fire? Doubt that the sun doth move? Doubt truth to be a liar, but never doubt I love. Oh, dear Ophelia, I am ill at these numbers. I have not arts to reckon my groans, but that I love thee best, oh, most best, believe it, adieu. Thine evermore most dear lady, whilst this machine is to him, Hamlet. This, in obedience, hath my daughter shown me, and more above, hath the solicitings as they fell out by time, by means, and place, all given to mine ear.
But how hath she received his love?
What do you think of me?
As of a man faithful and honorable?
I would fain prove so, but what might you think when I'd seen this hot love on the wing as I perceived it? I must tell you that, before my daughter told me, I went round to work. And my young mistress, thus I did bespeak, Lord Hamlet is a prince out of thy star. This must not be. And then I precepts gave her that she should lock herself from his resort, admit no messengers, receive no tokens, which done, she took the fruits of my advice, and he repulsed a short tale to me, fell into a sadness, then into a fast, thence to a watch, thence to a weakness, thence to a lightness, and and by this declension into the madness wherein he now raves, and all we mourn for.
Do you think 'tis this?
It may be, very likely.
Hath there been such a time? I fain know that. Could I have positively said 'tis so when it proved otherwise?
Not that I know.
Take this from this, if this be otherwise. If circumstances lead me, I will find where the truth is hid, though it were hid indeed within the center.
How might we try this further?
You know, sometimes he walks 4 hours together right here in the lobby.
So he does indeed.
At such a time, I lose my daughter to him. Be you and I behind an errand, then. Mark the encounter. If he love her not, and be not from his reason fallen thereon, let me be no assistant for a state, but keep a farm and parters.
We will try it.
But look, where sadly the poor wretch comes reading.
Away, I do beseech you, both away. I'll board him presently. Oh, give me leave. How does my good Lord Hamlet?
Well, God a mercy.
Do you know me, my lord?
Excellent, well, you are a fishmonger.
Not I, my lord.
Then I would you were so honest a man.
Honest, my lord.
Aye, sir, to be honest, as this world goes, is to be one man, picked out of 10,000.
That is very true, my lord.
For if the sun breed maggots and a dead dog, being a good kissing carrion, have you a daughter?
I have, my lord.
Let her not walk in the sun. Conception is a blessing, but not as your daughter may conceive. Friend, look to it.
How say you by that? Still harping on my daughter, yet he knew me not at first. He said I was a fishmonger. He is far gone, far gone. And truly in my youth, I have suffered much extremity for love. Very near this. I'll speak to him again. What do you read, my lord?
Words, words, words.
What is the matter, my lord?
Between who?
I mean the matter that you read, my lord.
Slanders, sir, for the satirical rogue says here that old men have gray beards, their faces wrinkled, their eyes purge in thick amber and plum tree gum, and that they have a plentiful lack of wit together with most weak hands. All which, sir, though I most powerfully and potently believe, though I do not hold it honesty to have it thus set down. For you, sir, should be as old as I am. If like a crab you could go backward.
Though this be madness, yet there is method in it. Will you walk out of the air, my lord?
Into my grave.
Indeed, that is out of the air. How pregnant sometimes his replies are. I will leave him, and suddenly contrive a means of meeting between him and my daughter. My honorable lord, I will most humbly take my leave of you.
You cannot, sir, take anything from me that I will more willingly part with all. Accept my life, accept my life, accept my life.
Very well, my lord.
These tedious old fools.
You go to see Lord Hamlet, there he is.
God save you, sir.
My honored lord.
My most dear lord.
Excellent, good friends, Guildenstern, Rosencrantz, good lads, how do ye both?
As the indifferent children of the earth.
Happy in that we are not over happy on Fortune's cap, you're not very buttoned.
Nor the soles of her shoes.
Neither, my lord.
Then you live about your waist or in the middle of her favor.
In faith of private sweet.
In the secret parts of Fortune, most true, she is a strumpet. What makes you at Elsinore?
To visit you, my lord, no other occasion.
Were you not sent for? Is it your own inclining of free visitation? Come, deal justly with me. Come, come. Nay, speak.
What should we say, my lord?
Why, anything to the purpose. You were sent for. There is a sort of confession in your look which your modesty has not fit enough to color. I know the good king and queen have sent for you.
To what end, my lord?
That you must teach me. Be even and direct with me whether you were sent for or no.
What say you?
I have an eye of you. If you love me, hold not off.
Where is that for?
Gentlemen, you are welcome to Elsinore. At your hands, the appetence of welcome is fashion and ceremony. Let me comply with you, Miss Garb, lest my extent to the players, which I must show fairly others, is more entertaining than yours. But my uncle, father, and aunt, mother are deceived.
And what, my dear lord?
Aye, and but mad north-northwest. When the wind is southerly, I know a hawk from a handsaw.
Well be with you, gentlemen.
Hark you, Guildenstern, and you too, every ear a hearer, that great baby. You see, there is not yet out of the swaddling float.
Happily, he's the second time come to them, where they say an old man is twice the child.
There are the players.
I prophesy he comes to tell me of the players. A Monday morning shall so indeed.
My lord, I have news to tell you.
My lord, I have news to tell you. Vernoshka was an actor.
The actors are come hither, my lord.
Buzz, buzz.
Upon my honor.
Then came each actor on his ass.
The best actors in the world. Either for tragedy, comedy, history, pastoral comical.
Oh, Jephthah, judge of Israel, what treasure hast thou?
What treasure hath he, my lord?
Why, one fair daughter, which he loved passing well.
Still am my daughter.
Am I not in the right, old Jephthah? Masters, you are all welcome. Good, my lord, let them be well bestowed. And do you hear? Let them be well bestowed, for there be abstract and brief chronicles of our time. After your death, we'd better have a bad epitaph than their ill report while we live.
My lord, I will use them according to their desert.
God's body, kinsman, use every man after his desert, and who should escape with it? Use them after your own honor and dignity. The less they deserve, the more merit is in their bounty. But take them in.
Come, sirs.
Follow him, friend. He'll have a play tomorrow night. Old friend, do you know the murderer of Gonzago?
Ha! Aye, my lord!
Very well. We'll have it tomorrow night. Could you, for a need, study some dozen or 16 lines which I would myself insert in it, could you not?
Aye, my lord.
Very well. Follow that lord there, and look you mock him not. My friends, I'll leave you till night. You're welcome to Elsinore.
Good, my lord.
Aye, sir. God be with you. Now I'm alone. Oh, what a rogue and peasant slave am I. Is it not monstrous that this player here, but in a fiction, in a dream of passion, comports his soul so to his own conceit that from her working all his visage wan. Tears in his eyes, distraction and respect, a broken voice in his whole function, suiting with forms to his conceit and all for nothing. For Hecuba, what Hecuba to him, or he to Hecuba, that he should weep for her, what would he do? Had he the motive and the cue for passion that I have, he would drown the stage with tears and cleave the general ear with horrid speech, make mad the guilty and appall the free. Confound the ignorant, amaze indeed the very faculties of eyes and ears, yet I, a dull and muddy-mettled rascal, peak like John of dreams, unpregnant of my cause, and can say nothing, no. Not for king, upon whose property and most dear life a damned defeat was made. Am I a coward? Who calls me villain, breaks my pate across, plucks off my beard and blows it in my face, gives me the lie, the throat as deep as to the lungs, who does me this? Swoons I should take it, for it cannot be. But I am pigeon-livered and lack gall to make oppression bitter. Or ere this, I should have fatted all the region's kites with this slave's awful, bloody body-building, remorseless
Treacherous, lecherous, kindless villain, oh vengeance, why was an ass am I? The son of a dear father. Murdered, must, prompted by revenge, by heaven and hell, must like a whore and pack my heart with words like a very scullion. Drab, fie upon it, foe about my brains.
I have heard that guilty creatures been struck so to the soul by the cunning of a scene that they have proclaimed their malfactions.
For murder, though it hath no tongue, speak with such miraculous organ.
I'll play something like the murder of my father before mine uncle.
I'll observe his looks. I'll tempt him to the quick. If he but blench, I'll know my course. The spirit I have seen may be the devil, and the devil hath power to assume a pleasing shape, and perhaps in my weakness and my melancholy, as he is potent which such spirits, abuses me to damn me. I'll have grounds more relative than this. The play's the thing wherein I'll catch the conscience of the king.
Or to take arms against the sea of troubles, and by opposing envy, to die, and to sleep, no more. And by sleep, we say, to end the heartache and thousand natural shocks that flesh is heir to. 'Tis a consummation devoutly to be wished. to die, to sleep, perchance to dream. Aye, there's the rope. For in that sleep of death, where dreams may come when we have shuffled off this mortal coil and must give us pause, there's the respect that makes calamity of so long life. For who would bear the whips and scorns of time, the oppressor's wrong, the proud man's contumely, pangs of despised love, the law's delay, the insolence of office, and the spurns that patient merit of his unworthy takes, when he himself might his quietest make with a bare bodkin? Who would fardels bear, to grunt and sweat under a weary life, that dread of something after death, that undiscovered country whose born no traveler returns, puzzles the will and makes us rather bear these ills than fly to others that we know not of? Thus conscience does make cowards of us all, and thus the native hue of resolution is sicklied o'er with pale cast of thought, and enterprise is of great pitch and moment. In this regard the currents turn awry, and we lose the name of action. Soft you now, the fair Ophelia, nymph in my origins, be all my sins remembered.
Good, my lord. How does your honor for this many a day?
I humbly thank you. Well, well, well.
My lord, I have remembrances of yours that I have long and longed to redeliver. I pray you now receive them.
No, not I. I never gave you aught.
My honored lord, you know right well you did. And with them words of so sweet breath composed as made the things more rich. Their perfume lost. Take these again, for to the noble mind rich gifts wax poor when givers prove unkind. There, my lord.
Are you honest?
My lord.
Are you fair?
What means your lordship?
That if you be honest and fair, your honesty should admit no discourse to your beauty.
Could beauty, my lord, have better commerce than with honesty?
Aye, truly. For the power of beauty will sooner transform honesty from what it is to a bawd, and the force of honesty can translate beauty into his likeness. This was sometime a paradox, but now time gives it proof. I did love you once.
Indeed, my lord. You made me believe so.
You should not have believed me. But virtue cannot so inoculate our old stock, but we shall relish of it. I loved you not.
I was the more deceived.
Get thee to another! Why wouldst thou be a breeder of sinners? I myself am different honest, but I can accuse me of such things that it were better my mother had not borne me. I am very proud, revengeful, ambitious, with more offenses in my beck than I have thoughts to put them in, imagination to give them shape, or time to act them in. What did such fellows as I do crawling between earth and heaven? Here are errant names all, believe not us. Go thy ways to another. Where's your father?
At home, my lord.
Let the doors be shut upon him. May he play the fool nowhere but in his own house. Farewell.
Help him, you sweet heavens.
If thou dost, Mary, I'll give thee this plague for thy dowry. Be thou as chaste as ice, as pure as snow, thou shalt not escape calumny. Get thee to an unary, farewell. If thou wilt needs marry, marry a fool. For wise men know what monsters you make of them. Get thee to an unary, quickly too, farewell.
Oh, heavenly powers, restore him.
I have heard of your paintings too, well enough. God has given you one face, and you make yourselves another. You jig, you amble, you lisp. You nickname God's creatures, and you make your wantonness your ignorance. Go to, on the moron to. It hath made me mad. I say, we will have no more marriages. Those that are married already, all but one shall live. The rest shall keep as they are. To a nunnery go.
Oh, what a noble mind is here o'erthrown. The courtiers,
soldiers, scholars, eye, tongue, sword, the expectancy and rose of the fair state, the glass of fashion and mold of form, the observed of all observers, quite down. And I, of ladies most deject and wretched, that sucked the honey of his music vows, thou see that noble and most sovereign reason, like sweet bells jangled out of tune and harsh, that unmatched form and feature of lone youth, blasted with ecstasy. Oh, woe's me, to have seen what I have seen. See what I see.
Love! His affections do not that way tend, nor what he spake, though it lacked form a little, was not like madness. There's something in his soul, over which his melancholy sits on brood, and I do doubt the hat and the disclose will be some danger. Which, for to prevent, I am with determination thus set it down. He shall with speed to England. To the demand of our neglected tribute, haply the seizing country's different, with variable objects shall expel the something settled matter in his heart, and his brain still beating puts him so far from fashion of himself. What thing do you want?
Enchanted well, but yet I do believe the origin and commencement of his grief sprung from neglected love. How now, Ophelia? You need not tell us what Lord Hamlet said. We heard it all.
My lord, do as you please, but if you hold it fit, after the play, let his queen mother all alone entreat him to show his grief. Let her be round with him, and I'll be placed, so please you, in the ear of all their conference. If she find him not, to England send him, or confine him where your wisdom best shall think.
It shall be so. Madness in great ones must not unwatched go.
Good, my lord. Will the king hear this piece of work?
And the queen, too, and that presently.
Bid the players make haste. Will you two help to hasten them?
We will, my lord.
What ho, Horatio!
Good, sweet lord, at your service.
Horatio, there's a play tonight before the king. One scene of it comes near the circumstance to which I have told thee of my father's death. Now seest this act afoot, observe mine uncle. For if his occulted guilt deny itself unkenneled in one speech, it is a damned ghost we have seen. Give him heedful note, for I mine eyes will rivet to his face, and we will both our judgments join after in censure of his seeming.
Well, my lord, if he steal off the whilst this play is playing and escape detecting, I will be the theft.
They're coming to the play. I must be either. Get you a place.
Aye, my lord.
Oh, God! You're only jig maker. What should a man do but be merry? For look you, how cheerfully my mother looks. And my father died within these 2 hours.
Nay, 'tis twice 2 months, my lord.
So long? Nay then, let the devil wear black, for I'll have a suit of sables. Now, heavens, died 2 months ago and not forgotten yet. And there's hope a great man's memory may outlive his life half a year. But by your lady, he must build churches then, or else he shall suffer not thinking on. The hobby horse, his epitaph is for O, the hobby horse is forgot.
Sweet, Leave me here a while. My spirits grow dull and fain I would beguile the tedious day with sleep.
Sleep rock thy brain and never let this chance between us two.
Madam, how like you display?
The lady doth protest too much, methinks.
Oh, but she'll keep her word.
Have you heard the argument? Is there no offense in it?
No, just much of a jest. Poison in jest. No offense in the world.
What call you this play?
A mousetrap. This one is Lucianus, nephew to the king.
You are as good as a chorus, my lord.
I could interpret between you and your love if I could see the puppets dallying.
You are keen, my lord, you are keen.
It cost you a groaning to take off my edge.
Still, better and worse.
So you mistake your husband's. Come, murderer pox, leave thy damnable faces and begin. Come, the croaking of the raven doth bellow for revenge.
Thoughts black, hands apt, drugs fit. In time agreeing, confederacies and else no creature sing. Thou mixture rank of midnight weeds collected with Hecate's band, thrice blasted, thrice infected. Thy natural magic and dire property on fulsome life, usurp immediately.
He poisons him in the garden for his estate. His name's Gonzago. The story is extant and written in choice Italian. You shall see anon how the murderer gets the love of Gonzago's wife.
The king rises.
What frightening false fire?
How fares, my lord?
Lord, what?
Give me some light! Away!
Light!
Why let the stricken deer go weep? The heart on goblins play. Some must watch while some must sleep. Thus runs the world away. Oh, good Horatio, I'll take the ghost's word for £1,000. It is received.
Very well, my lord.
Upon the charge of poisoning.
I did very well note him.
Oh, come some music. Come the reporters. For if the king not like the comedy, why then be like blood to not hurt him. Come some music. Sequel at the heels of this admiration, in part.
She desires to speak with you ere you go to bed.
You will obey were she 10 times our mother. Have you any further trade with us?
My lord, you once did love me.
So do I still, by these pickers and stealers.
Good my lord, what is your cause of distemper?
Come, the reporters, let me see one. Withdraw. Why is it you go about to recover the wind in me, as if you were to drive me into a toil?
Oh, my lord, if my duty be too bold, my love is too mannerly.
I do not well understand that. Will you play upon this pipe?
My lord, I cannot.
I pray you.
Believe me, I cannot.
I do beseech you.
I know no touch of it.
'Tis as easy as lying. Govern these bandages with your fingers, give it breath with your mouth, and it will discourse most eloquent music. Look you, these are the stops.
But these cannot. I command to any utterance of harmony. I have not the skill.
Oh, look how unworthy a thing you make of me. You would seem to play upon me, you would seem to know my stops. You would pluck out the heart of my mystery, you would sound me from my lowest note to the top of my compass. There is much music, excellent voice in this little organ, yet you cannot make it speak. Split. Do you think I am easier played upon than a pipe? Call me what instrument you will. Though you can fret me, you cannot play upon me. God save you, sir!
My lord, the queen would speak with you, I'm present.
Do you see yonder cloud that's almost in the shape of a camel?
By the mass, and it's just like a camel indeed.
Methinks it is like a weasel.
It is backed like a weasel?
Or like a whale.
Very like a whale.
And I will come to her by and by. They do fool me to the top of my bent. I will come by and by.
I will say so.
By and by is easily said. Leave me, friends. It is now the very witching time of night. The churchyards yawn and hell itself breathes out contagion to this world. Now could I drink hot blood and do such deeds as the day would quake to look on. Soft. Now to my mother. Heart lose not thy nature, nor let the soul of Nero ever enter this firm bosom. I will speak daggers to her, but use none. My tongue and soul in this be hypocrites. How in my words soever she be shent, to give them seals never my soul consent.
Not endure hazard so dangerous as doth our only grow out of his lunacy.
We will haste us.
My lord, he's going to his mother's closet. Behind the arras I'll convey myself to hear the process, and warrant shall tax him home. And as you said, and wisely was it said, 'tis meet that more audience than a mother, since nature makes them partial, should overhear the speech of Andrew. Fare you well, my liege. I'll call upon you ere you go to bed and tell you what I know.
Thanks, dear mother. Oh, my offense is rank, it smells to heaven. It hath the primal Elvis curse upon it, a brother's murder. Pray can I not? My stronger guilt defeats my strong intent. I stand and pause where I shall first begin. What if this cursed hand were thicker than brother's blood? Is there not enough rain in the sweet heavens to wash it as white as snow? Oh, what form of prayer can serve my turn? Forgive me my foul murder? That cannot be, since I am still possessed of those effects for which I did the murder. My crown, my own ambition, and my queen. May one be pardoned and retain the offense? Help, angels! Make a say! Bow stubborn knees and heart with strings of steel. Be as soft as sinews of the newborn babe. All may be well.
So he goes to heaven, and so I am revenged.
That would be scanned. A villain kills my father, and for that I, his sole son, do this same villain send to heaven.
Is
This is Hiram's tower, not revenge.
He took my father grossly, full of bread, with all his crimes broad blown as flesh is may. Whereas on it stands, who knows save heaven? But whatever circumstance and course of thought, 'tis heavy with him. So am I then revenged to take him in the purging of his soul, when he is fit and seasoned for his passage? No. Upley, I know thou a more horrid hent, when he is drunk asleep, or in his rage, or in the incestuous pleasure of his bed, at gaming or swearing or about some act that has no relish of salvation in it, then trip him, that his heels may kick at heaven, and his soul may be as black and damned as hell whereto it goes.
My mother stays. This physic but prolongs thy sickly days.
My words fly up, my thoughts remain below. Words without thoughts never to heaven go.
From the fair forehead of an innocent love and sets a blister there. The very soul is thought-sick at the act.
I mean, what act?
Look here upon this picture. The counterfeit presentment of two brothers. This was your husband. Look you now what follows. Here is your husband. Like a mildewed ear, blasting his wholesome brother. Have you eyes? You cannot call it love, for at your age, the hate in the blood is tame. Oh, shame, where is thy blush?
Oh, Hamlet, speak no more. Thou turn'st mine eyes into my very soul, and there I see such black
and grained spots will not leave their tink.
Nay, but to live in the rank sweat of an unseamed bed? Student corruption, honeying and making love over the nasty stars?
Speak to me no more! These words like daggers in mine ears. No more, sweet Hamlet.
A murderer and a villain. A slave that is not 20th part the type of your precedent, Lord. A vice of kings. A cutpurse of the empire and the rule that from the shelf the precious diamond stole and put it in his pocket.
No more.
A king of shreds and patches.
Oh, save me and hover o'er me with your wings, you heavenly guards. What would your gracious figure?
Alas, he's mad.
Do not come your tardy scent to chide, but lapsed in time and passion. Let's go by the important acting of your dread command. Say,
do not forget.
This visitation is but to wet thy almost blunted purpose. But look.
Amazement on thy mother sits.
Oh, step between her and her fighting soul.
Conceit in weakest body, strongest works.
Speak
to her.
Hamlet.
Hamlet.
How is it with you, lady?
Alas, how is it with you? And you do bend your eye on vacancy, and with the incorporeal air do hold discourse. Forth at your eyes, your spirits wildly peep, and as the sleeping soldiers in the alarm. Wetted hair, like life in excrement, starts up and stands on end. Oh, gentle son, upon the heat and flame of thy distemper, sprinkle cool patience. Whereon do you look?
On him. On him! Look you how pale he glares! This foreman calls conjoined, preaching the stones would make them capable. Do not look upon me. Lest with this piteous action you convert my stern offense. Then what I have to do will want true color. Tears perchance for blood.
To whom do you speak this?
Do you see nothing there?
Nothing at all, yet all that is I see.
Nor do you nothing here?
No. Nothing but ourselves.
Look. How he steals away my father in his habit as he lived. Look where he goes even now. Out at the portal.
This is the very coinage of your brain. This bodiless creation ecstasy is
ecstasy.
Very cunning.
Confess yourself to heaven. Repent what's past. Avoid what is to come. And do not spread compost on the weeds to make them rancor.
Oh, Hamlet, thou hast cleft my heart in twain.
Throw away the worser part of it and live the purer with the other half. Good night. But go not to mine uncle's bed. Assume a virtue, if you have it not. Refrain tonight, and that shall lend a kind of easiness to the next abstinence. Once again, good night. And when you are desirous to be blessed, all blessing beg of you. For this same Lord I do repent. But heaven hath pleased it so to punish me with this and this with me, that I must be their scourge and minister. I will bestow him, and will answer well the death I gave him. Once again, good night. I must be cruel only to be kind. Thus bad begins and worse remains behind. One word more, good lady.
What shall I do?
Not this. By no means I think you do. Let the bloat king tempt you again to bed. Pinch wanton on your cheek. Call you his mouse. And let him, for a pair of reachy kisses, make you to ravel all this matter out. I essentially am not in madness, but mad in craft.
Be thou assured, if words be made of breath and breath of life, I have no life to breathe what thou hast said to me.
I must to England, you know that?
Alack, I had forgot. 'Tis so concluded on.
There's letters sealed, and my two schoolfellows, whom I will trust as adder's fang, they bear the mandate. They must sweep my way and marshal me to knavery. Which is most sweet when in one line two crafts directly meet. This man shall set me packing. I'll lug the guts into the neighbor room. Mother, good night.
Indeed, this counselor is most still, most secret, and most brave. It was in life a foolish and prating knave.
Come, sir, draw Orton and Lucky. Good night, mother.
Sighs, these profound heaves. You must translate this bit we understand. Where is your son?
Bestow this place on us a little while. Oh, my good lord, what have I seen tonight?
What, Gertrude? How does Hamlet?
Mad as the sea and wind would both contend which is the mightier. In his lawless fit, behind the arras, hearing something stir, whips out his rapier, cries, "A rat, a rat!" And in this brainish apprehension, kills the unseen good old man.
Oh, heavy deed! It had been so with this had we been there. His liberty is full of threats to us all, to you yourself, to us, to everyone. Alas, how shall this bloody deed be answered? It will be laid to us, whose providence should have kept short, restrained and not upon. This mad young man, but so much was our love. We would not understand what was most fit, but like the owner of a foul disease to keep it from divulging, we must let it feed even on the pith of life. Where is he gone?
To draw apart the body he hath killed, or whom his very madness shows itself pure. He weeps for what is done.
Oh, come away, Gertrude. We will ship him hence and this vile deed. We must, with all our majesty and skill, both countenance and excuse. Ho, Gildan's thirst! Friends both, go join you with some further aid. Hamlet in madness hath Polonius slain, and from his mother's closet hath he dragged. Go seek him out, speak fair, and bring the body to the chapel. I pray you patience. Hasten this. Come, Gertrude, we'll call up our wisest friends and let them know both what we mean to do and what's untimely done. Well, come away, my soul is full of discord and dismay.
Thank you. is with the king, but the king is not with the body. The king is a thing.
A thing, my lord?
Of nothing.
Bring me to him. I talk to him after.
I sent them to go seek the body. How dangerous is it that this man goes loose? Yet, must not we put the strong law on him? He's loved of the distracted multitude. This sudden sending him away must seem deliberate pause. Disease is desperate grown by desperate appliance, are relieved or not at all. How now? What hath befallen?
Where the body is bestowed, my lord, we cannot get from him.
But where is he?
Without, my lord, guarded to know your pleasure.
Bring him before us.
Ho, Guildenstern, bring in my lord!
Now, Hamlet, where's Polonius?
At supper.
At supper? Where?
Not where he eats, but where he is eaten.
A certain convocation of politic worms are eaten at him. Your worm is your only emperor for diet.
We fat all creatures else to fat us, and we fat ourselves for maggots.
Your fat king and your lean beggar are of a variable service. Two dishes, but to one table.
That's the end.
Alas, alas.
A man may fish with the worm that hath eat of a king, and eat of the fish that hath fed of that worm.
What dost thou mean by this?
Nothing but to show you how a king may go a progress through the guts of a beggar.
Where is Polonius?
In heaven. Soon thither to see. If your messengers find him not there, seek him in the other place yourself. Indeed, if you find him not within this month, you shall nose him as you go up the stairs into the lobby.
Go seek him there.
He must stay till you come.
Hamlet, this deed for thine especial safety, which we do tender, as we dearly grieve for which thou hast done, must send thee hence with fiery quickness. The bark is ready, the wind at help, the associates tend, and everything is bent for England.
For England?
Aye, Hamlet.
Done!
So is it if thou knowest our purposes?
I see each other that sees them. But come, for England.
Farewell, dear mother.
Thy loving father, Hamlet.
My mother. Father and mother is man and wife. Man and wife is one flesh.
And so, my mother.
Come for England!
Follow him at foot, tempt him to speed aboard, delay it not. I'll have him hence tonight. Away! For everything that else leans on the affair is sealed and done. Make haste! In England, if my love thou holdest at aught, as my great power thereof may give thee sense, since yet thy cicatrice looks raw and red after the Danish sword, and thy free eye pays homage to us, thou mayest not coldly set our sovereign process, which imports at full, by letters congruent to that effect, that present death of Hamlet. Do it, England, for like the hectic in my blood, he rages. And thou must cure me, till I know 'tis done, however my haps, my joys ne'er begun.
Thank you.
not speak with her.
She is importunate, indeed distraught.
What her moves...
Who needs be pitied? She speaks much of her father. Says she hears there's tricks in the world, and hems and beats her heart. Spurns enviously its straw, speaks things in doubt that carry but half sense. Her speech is nothing, yet the unshaped use of it doth move the hearers to collection. They aim at it, and botch the words up to fit to their own thoughts, which, as her wakes and nods and gestures yield them, indeed would make one think there might be thought, though nothing sure, yet much unhappily.
'Twere good she was spoke with, for she may strew dangerous conjectures in ill-breeding minds.
Let her come in.
Where is the beauteous majesty of Denmark?
How now, Ophelia?
How sure that I, your true father, now from another one, I'm his cockle hat and staff and sandal shoe.
Alas, sweet lady, what imports this song?
They pray you, Mark. He is dead and gone, lady. He is dead and gone. At his head, a grass green turf. At his heels, a stone.
Nay, but Ophelia.
Pray you, Mark. White. Shout as the mountain snow.
Alas, look here, my lord.
Guarded with sweet flowers, watch who wept in the grave did go with true love showers.
How do you pray, lady?
Well, God illed you. They say the owl was the baker's daughter. God, we know what we are, but not what we may be. God be at your table.
Conceit upon her, father.
Pray you, let's have no more words of this. When they ask you what it means, say you this. Tomorrow is St. Valentine's Day, and all the world be time. Then die a maid at your window to be your Valentine. Then up he rose, and donned his clothes, and dumped the chamber door, that in the maid, that out the maid, never departed more.
Pretty Ophelia. In a deep grief, it springs all from her father's death. Oh, Gertrude, Gertrude, when sorrows come, they come not in single spice, but in battalions. First, her father slain. Next, your son is gone. The people muttered thick and unwholesome in their thoughts and whispers.
Forget Polonius to poor Ophelia, divided from herself and her fear of judgment. Her brother is in secret come from France. Feeds on wonder, keeping clouds, and wants no buster to infect his ear with pestilent speeches of his father's death. Oh, my dear Gertrude, this, like to a murdering peace in many places, keeps me superfluous death.
Alack, what noise is this?
Where are my Switzers? Let them guard the doors. What is the matter?
Save yourself, my lord. The ocean overpouring of his lips eats not the flats with more impetuous haste than young Laertes in a riotous head. The rabble call the lord, and as the world were now but to begin, antiquity forgot, custom not known, the ratifiers and props of every word, they cry, choose we, Laertes shall be king. Cap, hands, and tongues applaud it to the clouds. Laertes shall be king, Laertes king.
How cheerfully on the false trail they cry. Oh, this is counter, you false Danish dogs!
Doors are broke.
Where's the king? Sir, stay hold out.
No!
I pray you, give me leave.
We will.
We will. Thank you.
Oh, thou vile king, give me my father.
Calmly, Laertes.
That drop of blood that's calm claims me bastard. Cries coupled to my father, brands the harlot, even here, between the chaste, unsmirched brow of my true mother.
What is the cost, Laertes? That thy rebellion seems so giant-like. Let him go, Gertrude. Do not fear our person. There's such divinity of such a king that treason can but peep to what it would ask little of his will. Tell him, Laertes, why art thou thus incensed? Let him go, Gertrude. Speak, man.
Where is my father?
Dead.
But not by him.
Let him demand his fill.
How came he dead? I'll not be juggled with. To hell, allegiance. Vows to the blackest devil. Conscience and grace, the profoundest pit. I dare damnation. To this point I stand that both worlds I give to negligence. Let come what comes. Only I'll be revenged, most thoroughly for my father.
Who shall stay here?
My will, not all the world's. And for my means, all has been them so well they shall go far with low.
Good Laertes. If you desire to know the certainty of your dear father's death, this writ in your revenge, that sweepstakes. You will draw both friends and foe.
And then his enemies.
Shall you know them then?
To his friends, thus wide I open my arms, and like the kind life-rendering pelican, repass them with my blood.
Why, now you speak like a good child and true gentleman. But I am guiltless of your father's death, and most sensible and grieved for it. I shall as level to your judgment, Pierce, as day does to your eye.
Let her come in!
Now, what noise is this? Here seven times off. I have the sense and virtue of my knife. Dear maid, kind sister, sweet Ophelia. Heaven.
I bore him barefaced on the bier. Hey, nonny, nonny, hey, nonny. And in his grave rained many a tear. Very well, my dog.
Hath saw my wits and did persuade revenge, it could not move us.
Oh, you must sing a down, a down, and when you call him a downer, oh, how the wheel becomes it. It is the false steward that stole his master's daughter.
This is nothing more than that.
There's Rosemary. That's for remembrance. Pray you love, remember. There's Pansy. That's for thoughts.
Documented madness. Thought and remembrance fitting.
There's fennel for you. There's room for you, and here's some for me.
some violets, but they withered all when my father died. They say he made a good end. The body, sweet Robin, is all my job.
Thought and affliction, passion, hell itself. She turns the favor in prettiness.
And will he not come again? And will he not come again? No, he is dead. Go to thy deathbed! His beard was as white as snow, and all flaxen was his wool. He is gone, and we cast away Maud. God have mercy on his soul. And all Christian souls, God be with you.
Do you see this, oh God?
There it is. You must commune with your grief. For you deny your rights. We'll put apart. Make choice of whom your wisest friends you will, and they shall hear and judge twixt you and me. If by direct, or by collateral hand, if I must touch, we will our kingdom give, our crown, our life, and everything that we can to you in satisfaction. But if not, will you consent to lend your patience to us, and we shall jointly labor with your soul to give a due consent.
Let this be so. His means of death, his obscure funeral. No trophy, sword, nor hatchment over his bones. No noble rite, no formal ostentation. Cry out to be heard, as 'twere from heaven to earth, that I must call it in question.
So you shall. And where the offense is, let the great axe fall. I pray you, go with me.
What are they that would speak with me? They say they have letters for you. Let them come in.
I do not know from what part of the world I should be greeted if not from Lord Hamlet.
God bless thee, sir.
Let him bless me too.
He shall, sir, and it leaves him. Here's a letter for you, sir, from the ambassador bound for England.
Horatio, thou shalt have overlooked this. Give these fellows some means to the king. They have letters for him. Ere we were 2 days old at sea, a pirate, a very warlike appointment, gave us chase. Finding ourselves too slow of sail, we put on a compelled bower, and in the gravel I boarded them. On the instant they got clear of our ship, so I alone became their prisoner. They have dealt with me like thieves of mercy, but they knew what they did. I am to do a good turn for them. Let the king have the letters I have sent, and repair thou to me with as much speed as thou wouldst fly death. In words to speak in thine ear that will make thee dumb, yet it may much too light for the bore of the matter. This good fellow will bring thee where I am. Rosencrantz and Guildenstern hold their course for England. Of them I have much to tell thee. Farewell. He that thou knowest thine, Hamlet.
Come, I will give you way for these your letters.
How now, what news?
Letters, my lord, from Hamlet. This to your majesty, this to the queen.
From Hamlet? Who brought them?
Sealers, my lord. So they say. I saw them not. They were given to me by Claudio. He received them of him that brought them.
Laertes, you shall hear them. Leave us. High and mighty, you shall know I am set naked on your kingdom. Tomorrow shall I beg leave to see your kingly eyes. When I shall, first asking your pardon thereunto, recount the occasion of my sudden and more strange return. Hamlet, what does this mean? Are all the rest come back? Or is this some sort of abuse or no such thing?
Know you the hand.
says Hamlet's character, naked. And here, in postscript, he says alone, can you advise me?
I'm lost in him. Let him come. It warms the very sickness in my heart that I shall live and tell him to his teeth, thus didst thou.
Laertes, if it were so, as to how should it be so? How otherwise? Will you be ruled by me?
I, my lord. So you will not rule me to a peace.
To thine own peace. If he not return, as checking at his voyage, and that he means no more to undertake it, I shall work him to an exploit. Now ripen my device, under the which he shall not choose but fall. And to his death, no one of blame shall grieve, for even his mother shall not charge the practice and call it accident.
I will be ruled, my lord. But the rather, if you could devise it so that I might be the organ.
Laertes, was your father dear to you? Or are you like a painting of a sorrow, a face without a heart?
Why ask you this?
If Hamlet now returned, what would you undertake to show your father's son indeed, more than in words?
To cut his throat in the church.
No place indeed should murder sanctuaries. Revenge should have no bounds. But good Laertes, will you do this? Keep close within your chamber. Hamlet returns shall know you are come home. We'll put on those shall praise your excellence, and set a double varnish on the fame the Frenchman gave you. Bring you in fine together and set a wager on your heads. He, being remiss, most generous and free from all contriving, will not peruse the foils, so that you may choose the sword unbated, and in a passive practice, requite him for your father.
I'll do it for that purpose. I bought an unction of mountebanks, so mortal that but dip a knife in it, where it draws blood, no cataplasm so rare, collected from all symbols under the moon that have virtue, can save the thing from death that is but scratched withal. I'll touch my blade with this contagion, so that if I gall him slightly, it may be death.
Let's further think of this. Weigh what convenience, for both time and means, may fit a sufficient fill. So, let me see. We'll set a solemn wager on your kindness. My habit was in motion, you were hot and dry, which make your vows more violent at the end, that you may call for drink. I have prepared him a chalice for the nonce, or on but sipping. If he by chance escape your venom stuck, our purpose may hold him there. How now, sweet queen?
One woe doth tread upon another's heel. So fast they follow. Your sister's drowned, Laertes.
Drowned? Where?
There is a willow, grows a slanted brook, it shows his hoar leaves in the glassy stream. There with fantastic garlands did she come. There on the pendant boughs, her coronet weeds clamoring to hang on. An envious lover broke. When down her weedy trophies and herself fell in the weeping brook. Her clothes spread wide, and then mermaid-like a while they bore her up. But long it could not be till that her garments, heavy with their drink, pulled the poor wretch from her melodious lay to muddy death.
Alas. And she's drowned.
Drowned.
Too much water hast thou, poor Phoebe. Therefore I forbid my tears. But yet that is our nature, our custom holds. Let shame say what it will. When these are gone, the woman will be out. Adieu, my lord. I have a speech that fame would blaze, but that this folly doubts it.
Let's follow Gertrude. How much I had to do to calm his rage. Now I fear this will give it start again. Therefore, let's follow.
In youth when I did love,
But age with his steely steps hath clawed me in his clutch, and hath shipped me into the land as if I had never been.
Yeah.
Such.
That skull had a tongue in it and could sing once. It might be the feet of a politician which this axe not or reaches. One that would circumvent God, might it not?
It might, my lord. A pickaxe and a spade for and a shrouded sheet, a pit of clay for to be made for such a guest is meet. Ugh.
Here's another. Why may not this be the school of a lawyer? Why does he suffer this rude knave now to knock him about the sconce with a dirty shovel?
I will speak to this fellow. Whose grave is this, sirrah?
Mine, sir.
I think it be thine indeed, for thou liest in it.
You lie out on it, sir, and therefore it is not yours. For my part, I do not lie in it, and yet it is mine.
Thou dost lie in it. To be inked and saved is thine. Tis for the dead, not for the quick. Therefore, thou liest.
Tis a quick lie. Twill away again from me to you.
What man dost thou dig it for?
For no man, sir.
What woman?
For none neither.
Who is to be buried it?
One that was a woman, sir. But rest her soul, she is dead.
How long hast thou been a grave maker?
Of all the days of the year! I came to it that day our last King Hamlet overcame Fortinbras.
How long is that since?
Cannot you tell that? Every fool can tell that. It was the very day that young Hamlet was born. He that is mad and sent it to England.
Aye, Mary. Why was he sent into England?
Why? Because he was mad! He shall recover his wits there. Or, if he do not, it's no great matter there.
Why?
Will it not be seen in him? There! Oh, the men are as mad as he!
How came he mad?
Strangely, they say.
How strangely?
Faith, Ian with losing his wits.
But soft, but soft. Aside, here comes the king, the queen, the couriers. Who is this they follow with such maimed rites? This doth betoken the course they followed it with desperate hand for Dogwood's own life. 'Twas of some estate. Couch me a while and mark.
What ceremony is?
That is Laertes, a very noble mark.
What ceremony else?
But that the great commander says the order she should, in ground unsanctified, have lodged her last trumpet. For charitable prayers, shards, flints, and stones should be thrown on her, yet here she is allowed her virgin crants, her maiden instruments, and the great common bell.
Must there no more be done?
No more be done. We should profane the service of the dead to sing a requiem and give her such rest as these parts.
Lay her in the earth, and from her unpolluted flesh may violets spring. I tell thee, churlish priest, a ministering angel shall my sister be when thou liest how.
What the fear of failure?
Sweet, sweet, farewell. I hoped thou shouldest have been my Hamlet's wife. I thought thy bride bed to have decked sweet maid, and not have strewed thy grave.
Trouble woe. Fall 10 times on that cursed head, his most wicked deed, thy most ingenious sense deprived thee. Hold off the earth a while! Till I have caught her once more in my arms.
What is he whose grief bears such an emphasis? Whose phrase of sorrow conjures the wandering stars and makes them stand like wounded hearers. This is I,
Hamlet the Dane.
Devil take thy soul. Thou prayest not well. I breathe. Take thy finger from my throat. For though I am not fletative and rash, yet I something in thee dangerous, which let thy wisdom fear. Hold off thy hands! Let him asunder!
Hamlet, Hamlet! Good, my lord, be quiet!
For I will fight with him upon this theme until my island will no longer wag.
Oh, my son, what theme?
I loved Ophelia! 40,000 brothers could not with all their quantity of love make up my sum! What will thou do for her?
Oh, he is mad, Laertes!
For love of God, forbear him.
Hear you, sir. What is the reason that you use me thus? I loved you ever, but it is no matter. Let Hercules himself do what he may. The cat will mew and dog will have his day.
I pray you, good Horatio. Wait upon him. Strengthen your patience in all last night's speech. Put the matter to the pressing question. Good Gertrude, sit some watch over your son.
This grave shall have a living monument!
An hour of quiet shortly shall we live. Till then, in patience are preceding thee.
So much for this, sir. Now shall you see the other. You do remember all the circumstance.
Remember it, my lord?
I found Horatio, royal knavery, an exact command that my head should be struck off.
Is it possible?
Here's the condition. Read it at more leisure, but wilt thou hear how I did proceed?
I beseech you.
Now, the next day was our sea fight, and what to this was secret, thou knowest already.
So Guildenstern and Rosencrantz go with it.
My man, they did make love to this employment. You're not near my conscience. Their defeat does by their own insinuation grow.
Why, what a king is this?
Does it not, thinkest thee, stand me now upon he that killed my king and whored my mother, and thrown out his anger for my proper life?
It must be shortly known to him from England what is the issue of the business there. Peace! Who comes here?
Your lordship! I welcome back to Denmark.
I humbly thank you, sir.
Just know this waterfall.
No, my good lord.
Sweet lord, if your lordship were at leisure, I should impart a thank to you from his majesty. He has laid a great wager on your head, sir, here newly comes to court Laertes, believe me, an absolute gentleman. He has laid 6 fodery horses against which he has imponed 6 French rapiers. And there are signs as girdles, hangers, and poniards, 3 of the most delicate courages.
Why is all this imposed, as you call it?
The king, sir, hath wagered that he shall not exceed you.
How if I answer no?
I mean, my lord, the very opposition of your persons in trial.
Sir, I will walk here in the halls. If it please his majesty, let the foils be brought, the gentleman willing, and the king hold his purpose. I will win for him, and I can. If not, I will gain nothing but my shame.
Shall I re-deliver your message in so?
To this effect, sir, after what flourish your nature will.
I commend my duty to your lordship.
Yours, yours. He does well to commend himself. There are no tongues else for his turn.
This lapwing runs away with the shell on his head.
My lord! His majesty commended him to you by young Osric, who brings back to him that you attend to him in the hall. He said to know if your pleasure holds the play with Laertes, or that you will take a longer time.
I am constant to my purpose. They follow the king's pleasure. If his fitness speaks, mine is ready, now or whensoever, provided I be so able as now.
The king and queen and all are coming down.
In happy time.
The queen desires you to use some gentle entertainment to Laertes before you fall to play.
She well instructs me.
You will lose this wager, my lord.
I do not think so. Since he went into France, I have been in continual practice. I shall win against the odds.
Come, Hamlet. Come. And take this hand from me. Give me your pardon, sir. I've done you wrong.
Do receive your offered love like love and will not wrong it.
I embrace it freely, will this brother's wager frankly play. He was the foil. Come on.
One for me.
I'll be your foil, Laertes.
Do you mock me, sir?
No, by this hand.
Then the foil is a mustard. Cousin Hamlet, you know the wager?
Very well, my lord. Your grace hath laid the odds on the weaker side.
I do not fear it. I have seen you both, but since he is better, we have therefore odds.
This is too heavy. Give me the other.
This likes me well.
Aye, my good lord.
Send me a stupid one point or two. Come, begin. And you, the judge, bear weary eye.
Come, sir. Come, my lord.
Here's to thy health. Give him the cup.
I'll play this bout first. Set it by a while. Come.
Justly killed with his own treachery. is a poison tempered by himself. Exchange forgiveness with me, Hamlet. My father and my death come out upon me. Lord, thine and me.
Heaven make thee free of it. I follow thee. I am dead, Horatio. O wretched queen, adieu. You that look pale and tremble at this chance, that are but mute or audience to this act, and I but time, as this spell certain death is strict in his arrest. Oh, I can tell you, but let it be. Horatio, I am dead. Thou livest. Report me and my cause aright to the unsatisfied.
Never believe it. I am more an antique Roman than a Dane. Here's yet some liquor left.
As thou art a man, give me the cup. Let go. By heaven, I'll have it. Oh, good Horatio, what a wounded name. Things standing thus unknown shall live behind me. If thou didst ever hold me in thy heart, perhaps I need from felicity a while, and in this harsh world, draw thy breath and pain to tell my story.
Now cracks a noble heart. Good night, sweet prince. Flights of angels sing thee to thy rest.